Please pray with me. Father, as we delve into your word about your word today, open our minds and hearts for that spiritual food that will cause us to grow closer to you, closer to each other. In Jesus' name, amen. What are we doing when we are being the church? That has been our question the last few weeks, and this week we come to the end of that series of words that are so important, starting with when we are worshiping. We are being the church, and we worship in spirit and in truth, and we learn that worship is about God and His grace coming to us, and we respond with our songs and our words. We talked about witnessing to that which we have seen and heard, witnessing to the truth of God's word as it is the absolute truth. And sometimes witnessing means being a martyr, suffering for that. Last week we talked about work, not just the work we do collectively as a congregation, but individually as Christians, wherever God has called us, to our job, to our station in life as a mom or a dad or wherever God has put us, we do our best because whatever we do, God is using us to get His purposes done. Today, what are we doing when we are being the church? We are about the Word of God. Now, thinking this through a little bit, we realize that the Word of God is the foundation to everything we do as a church. Without God's communication to us about Jesus, about the cross, about the empty tomb, about the gift of faith, if we didn't have that, we'd have nothing to worship. We wouldn't know who God is. If we didn't have the Word, what would we witness? You know, that's like I heard one comedian talking about agnostic missionaries. An agnostic is one who doesn't know if there's a God or not. Can you imagine someone knocking on your door? What do you think about God? I don't have a clue. That would be kind of what we would be if we didn't have the Word of God telling us the truth. And of course, our work, why would we bother doing it if we weren't motivated? Because God cares for people. We care for them too, and so we have hospitals and education and human care ministries. In another sense, the Word of God also is supported and held up by the foundation of Jesus Christ. John 1:1, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's our Lord Jesus. And He comes to us in not only the written word, the Bible, but also that written word connected with the waters of baptism. That's what our Lutheran Schools Week was all about, is baptism. What a gift it is to have be given that faith. And also the Lord's Supper, where the Word of God is connected to some ordinary things, bread and wine, and they become extraordinary gifts of the very body and blood of Jesus Christ. But as you see, the Word in every case is the foundation. The Word is fundamental to the Christian faith. Fundamentals are important. The basketball player, the great Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, was asked one time, who is your most influential coach? And he immediately said, John Wooten of UCLA. And the reporter asked him, why was Wooten so influential? He said, because Wooten was absolutely committed to and passionate about the fundamentals of the game of basketball. So, well, what do you mean? Well, our first gathering as players at UCLA, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar told, John Wooten brought us all into the locker room and sat us all down. The first thing he did is he taught us how to put our socks on so that we wouldn't get blisters. Now, that's as fundamental as you can get, isn't it? And then the second thing he did is he taught us how to tie our shoes so they wouldn't come untied. And that was his way of giving them a solid foundation. We need that fundamental. And I was reminded, I don't know if there's any Green Bay fans in here today. We usually have one or two. Oh, we got a couple, all right. The great Vince Lombardi, of course, remember him as one of the greatest coaches ever. And after a devastating loss, maybe you remember the speech where he got all the guys in the locker room and held up a football and said, "Gentlemen, this is a football." It's almost as if he thought they forgot what it was because they played so bad and went back to the fundamentals. Well, that's what we do with God's Word. Back to the fundamentals, the very communication to us. God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, fundamental, important. Jesus Christ, his only Son, who died, who rose again, who gives us heaven. The Holy Spirit, who comes to us and gives us the gifts of the Spirit and of faith. We are a fundamentalist church. Now, you hear about, often in the media, how the fundamentalist churches are, you know, they're the haters, they're the bigots. Couldn't be farther from the truth. A true fundamentalist church, as I believe we are, is about that foundation of the Word of God. It is so very important. Just want to share one passage with you from 2 Timothy chapter 3:16. And in this passage, I'd like to read the first two lines together and then we'll stop. Here we go. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for. Okay, let's stop there. Breathed out by God. That's one of the fundamentals of understanding God's Word, is it is inspired by God. Inspire, breathed out. God's breath is the literal Greek. He breathed it into prophets like Jeremiah and Isaiah and the apostles and the evangelists, and they wrote down and gave us exactly what God would have us know. Inspired. That's where we start. As a fundamental truth of God's Word. And it is because it is God's Word about God and not man's Word about God. It is true and it is inerrant and it is profitable. Let's finish the passage. Profitable for, here we go, teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Reproof. What does that mean? Reproof is a kind of a confrontational word. Okay? We know God, we believe in Him, but we sin and we go against His will. And sometimes we absolutely, if God is represented by the altar and the window, we absolutely walk away from Him. And we do things that He doesn't want us to do, that are sinful, that are against His will. You name it, and it's there. Reproof means something's poof right in front of us to prove to us that it's against God's will, and that comes from His Word. It's called the law, the Ten Commandments. And when we believe in God, we can run right into that, and it stops us. And then comes the joy of correction. That's the next word, repentance. He turns us around. And we head back toward Him. Our behavior changes because at that moment, we realize we have let God down, we have sinned, but Jesus paid for that sin, so we don't have to be punished for it. We can be turned around and brought back closer to God and corrected back into His presence. The Word of God does that marvelous and wonderful gift of reproof and correction. A course correction, if you will. Now, there are some things that we don't sin about, but we need to know what God would have us do. How does He want us to live? Let's get ahead of it and get there before we sin, and that's the training in righteousness. It's called sanctification, and it becoming more and more holy, more and more like God, and the Word gives us how to do that. Now, we'll never be perfect because we're human. We're always going to be sinful human beings, but in this process of reproof, of correction, of training, we become more and more Christ-like. That's the goal for all of us, so that one day we will be complete, thoroughly furnished and equipped to do the work that God has given us to do. That's the fundamental reason that He has given us Holy Scripture. And I will tell you that that Scripture is living and powerful. Now, I want to be careful here. By living, I don't mean a living document that changes and adapts to the times. No. It is complete as it is. but living in that it makes a difference in our lives. It's powerful. It changes. It turns. It does all of those things that we have been talking about. What's interesting is that it's an eternally living document. God's Word will go into eternity with human souls. Not much else will. So many have tried to kill God's Word and its influence in our world. There are several philosophers of the past who really thought that they could do that. One of them was named Robert Ingersoll. Robert Ingersoll came to believe that the world was not created by God, which was considered a horrible thing to say back in his day. And he said, oh, when I realized that it's all natural and there is no God, he said, my soul was freed. I have a hard time understanding that, because there's no more freedom than the freedom that God gives us in the gospel. But at one point, he held up a Bible, and he said, in 15 years, I'll have this Bible in the morgue. It'll be dead. In 15 years, Robert Ingersoll was in the morgue, and the Bible lives to this day. Voltaire, the famous French philosopher, said, in 100 years, the Bible will be an outdated, outmoded, forgotten book. The only place you'll find the Bible is in a museum. When 100 years were up, Voltaire's house was owned by the Geneva Bible Society and is used to print Bibles. Thomas Paine said that within one generation, the Bible would no longer be printed at all. The very printing press that printed those words of his now prints Bibles. God's Word is living and powerful. The great Charles Spurgeon was asked to defend the Bible by a critic. Reverend Spurgeon, defend that Bible to me that it's true. Spurgeon didn't say a word. Dr. Spurgeon, defend the Bible to me. Show me that it's true. Again, he didn't say a word. The man asked, why won't you defend the Bible to me? And Spurgeon said, the Bible is alive. It's like a lion. Listen to me now. It's like a lion. All I got to do is turn it loose and it'll defend itself. And isn't that the truth, living and powerful? It is based on the basis of this powerful Word of God that Peace Ministries and Peace School exist. What a joy it is to have the opportunities in the Word, being the church. What are we doing? We're in the Word. I just did some rough calculations. If you take the number of students we have and the number of hours that they are in school, we have approximately 600,000 hours in pupil time to share the Word of God with them. Wow. That's just K through 8. Preschool is another 60,000 hours to be with the pupils, the children, to bring them God's Word. 37 chapel services and innumerable opportunities to share the gospel. In addition to that, the ministries of peace include thousands of volunteer and staff teaching hours in confirmation, Sunday Bible club, kids connection, adult studies, small group studies for adults and youth, and countless other opportunities. So that when we have the Word of God, what are we doing? We're being the church in our worship, in our witness, and in our work. So today, that leads me to say with you, thank God. Thank God for that foundation. Thank God for the ability to have something to worship that's true, something to witness that's absolute, and something to work toward that gives every day of our lives meaning and purpose. And I also want to say thank you, members of Peace, supporters of this congregation and school. The fact is that it's very expensive to do the things we do here at Peace. And many of you parents are sacrificing a great deal to pay tuition, some grandparents as well. And all of us who are members of Peace are sacrificing what God has given us and joyfully giving it back to Him so that we can continue the Word of God and the foundation that it is building in the lives of children and adults. The Children of Peace have a little thank you for you in the form of a video. Let's watch. In a preschool here in Michigan a number of years ago, one of the little girls that looked about like one that was up there in the four-year-old class, her family didn't know Jesus very well, and she came to a Lutheran preschool, and she learned of Him. And her favorite book in the world was written by Dr. Paul Meyer. It's called The Very First Christmas. Wonderful book. If you don't have it, consider getting it. It teaches the true meaning of Christmas and the gift of faith. And that little girl just loved that book to be read to her. Her mom said almost every night. Tragically, through domestic violence, that little girl lost her life. But because of the ministry of that Lutheran preschool and the teachers there, the pastor could say confidently at her funeral that this little girl, baptized and knowing Jesus as her Savior, is in the arms of God, and they will see her again. Is the word important? Is giving it to our children at home, at church, at school significant? It's a matter of life and death eternally. And I thank God that we have the opportunities we do to bring Jesus, the Word made flesh, to people of all ages. Let's stand and pray about it.